I've carried a burden for too long on my own. I wasn't created to bear it alone. I hear your invitation. Soul needs a friend, so I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again. Oh, oh, oh. You saw
Welcome to North Shore, and thanks for being with us this morning. I've been looking forward to this time together as we pray and worship and study. You know, folks that are part of this 9 o'clock home-to-home version have been coming out of the woodwork and hearing from you, and I love hearing from you. I love to hear from you online as we're rolling, but also love hearing from you through the week, your feedback, your encouragement, your questions. I really look forward to this this time on Sunday mornings, this 9 o'clock home-to-home time. And like I said, I sure appreciate it when you like and share and subscribe, you interact via the comments. All of that's important because, well, we want to know how you're doing and what's going on, but it also helps us sort of popularize this stream on Facebook and YouTube, triggers the algorithms and such. So thank you for interacting online, sharing this, and letting people know that we're gathering here at 9 on Sundays. As always, glad to have your prayer requests as well. We go about our work of prayer together throughout the week, especially on Tuesday mornings. And we'd like to add your requests. So, well, here we go. I'm just, like I said, looking forward to what we have to share today together. So let's engage and sing and pray and just lean in. So we're going to turn our attention to a song, worshiping together, setting our focus upward on God, I like to say. This song, well, it really proclaims the gospel. It proclaims that God is worthy of our songs, worthy of our praise, worthy of our devotion. The song proclaims Jesus as the name above every name. It calls out to God for gifts of faith, calls out to God for his leading, and it proclaims a decision to devotion, to build our lives on the firm foundation of our Savior, Jesus. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God, the hope of Jesus. Remember, hope is not merely a wish, like we might often think in our common use of the word hope. When we're talking about hope in God, the one in whom we place our hope is all-powerful and entirely faithful. Hope, in this biblical context, is a trustworthy promise. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. When we are His, when we're His, God does not waste pain. Where there is struggle and pain, God transforms it into perseverance, character, and more hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. Our hope is more than a wish, even more than a promise. Our hope is a person, God personified with us. Our hope has a name. His name? Well, His name is Jesus.
Savior's cross has set this sin.
Let's be sure to receive that great hope today. Friends, today is a day to believe. Today is a day to enjoy hope that comes through Jesus and praise Him for it. Today is a day to be a member of His family, a citizen in His kingdom. Today is a day to believe. Allow me to continue with Romans 5. You see, just at the right time, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates His own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Do you ever wonder if you matter? Friend, you matter. Know that you are loved. You matter. Christ died for you. Jesus died for me. We matter to God. Since we have now been justified by His blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through Him, through Jesus? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to Him through the death of His Son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through His life? Make today your day and believe. Believe again, just like I am. I'm believing again today. Or perhaps you've never taken that step to believe. This is all that God requires, that we believe Jesus today, that we believe in Jesus. Respond to God's call today. Respond to His love for us. Respond to the Holy Spirit. It can all start with a simple three-word prayer. Jesus, I believe. Know God's love. Be a citizen of His kingdom. Believe today. Pray it with me today. Jesus, I believe. Jesus, I believe. I know that God responds to that prayer. I know it because He is faithful.
It's
Our Father, we worship you for all you've done, for all you are, for all you promise. We worship you. We worship you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Amen. Well, friends, again, let me encourage you to engage with us online. Share and subscribe, like and comment and such. We want to know you're there. If we can be praying with you, send your prayer requests along. If you plan to be with us next Sunday in the auditorium there in Kenmore, we are firing up. We are getting going again with Discovery Kids, our children's ministry, Kids Church, and Nursery next week in the second service, so only the 10:30 service. Discovery Kids and Nursery. Discovery Kids will be with us. Kids will be with us at the beginning of the service, and then we'll dismiss them to go with Pastor Allison and the team that's helping her. Speaking of the team, there's room for help. We're going to get started every other week with Discovery Kids and Nursery. I would love to make it every week, but that is all just a matter of staff, volunteer staff. So if you might be able to help us with the kids, either in the nursery with the littles, or with Discovery Kids, the elementary age kids, let us know. You can let me know, or you can let Allison know, and we'd be glad to put you to work. So thanks for helping out with all of that. And thank you for your faithfulness in giving. If North Shore is your church home, or this live stream, this Sunday morning broadcast is your church home, wherever you are, I hope you'll join us in supporting our work together at North Shore. With your tithes and offerings, your regular giving to the work at North Shore, or your designated gifts to missions, or the food bank, or wildfire relief, we are glad to receive your giving online with the tools there, or you can mail it in and drop it off. Thank you for your giving. We couldn't do it without your support. There's no other economic engine. This is how we fund the work of God together. So thank you for your faithfulness. Can we pray together? Father, thank you for this opportunity to give, and thank you also for this opportunity to pause and give you thanks, to acknowledge you again as our provider. We count you as our giver of every good gift. You bless us. You are our provider. And we thank you for this opportunity to be involved like this in your work with these gifts, these sacrifices, these tithes, these offerings. Thank you for the way that we get to be involved like this. Thank you for the faithful hands that'll put it to good work. Thank you most of all for the Holy Spirit that works in it and through it, guides it, directs it, empowers it, so that it truly does accomplish eternal things. Thank you for your blessing. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, it is a big day at North Shore. We're starting a new series. We'll keep up with our current series, this current series that's from the Gospel of Luke, which will continue through the book of Acts. But I usually like to have a couple of series going at any given time. So we'll get started today with a series from the New Testament book of Hebrews that I'm calling Christ Superior. Today I'm not only calling the series Christ Superior, I've titled this message Christ Superior. I think we have a lot to look forward to here. In what I currently have sketched out as a 21-part series spreading over the coming 11 or 12 months. So this book of Hebrews will serve as a great complement to what we are working through in the Gospel of Luke. Right? In Luke, we have a narrative. Our focus is on the words of Jesus. In Hebrews, we have a more theological presentation. Luke is a history, a presentation of what happened. In Hebrews, we'll have more of an explanation. Luke is kind of linear, day by day, step by step. Hebrews, well, it kind of sees it all as a whole. Luke is what happened. Well, Hebrews is what it means. Hebrews is especially interesting because there's some mystery surrounding the book. Some have described the book of Hebrews as the riddle of the New Testament. It isn't because there's some riddle that needs to be cracked or that it contains some sort of, secrets. But Hebrews lacks clear answers to some really basic questions. Questions like, when was it written? To whom was it written? Why was it written? And who wrote it? These are all some of the questions that, well, it kept the book of Hebrews out of the earliest lists of what we call the canon, the accepted books of the Bible. Do you think much about how we got the Bible? I've been thinking a bit about doing some sort of online class or Bible study, something that we can do together, likely with Zoom, to learn something, of course, but also to provide an opportunity for discussion and community building. So, I don't know, maybe we should do a study on the Bible, how we got it, and how we should read it. Well, if that sounds interesting to you, would you let me know? Or if you have a better idea of what we could do together, I'd be glad to hear that too. The Bible is, of course, all a result of God working through people. Now, we probably think in those terms mostly when we think about God working through the authors of the biblical books, right? Like Luke penned the Gospel of Luke and Paul penned Romans and, well, a lot of the rest of the New Testament too. But even the compilation of the biblical books, the list of the books that are included, is a result of God working through people, various early church councils, people thinking and praying and consulting together to invite God's direction and determine which books will comprise the canon. Well, the book of Hebrews was among the latest entries, and a lot of what kept Hebrews out of the earliest lists are questions like these that surround the book. It turns out that disputes about this book were common early on and have persisted throughout the ages, including doubts and concerns from, well, significant church figures like Luther and Calvin. Heard of those guys? For the record, we don't have any of those concerns, right? Obviously, we wouldn't be doing a series if we had such problems. Most contemporary churches, leaders, and scholars, especially of our ilk, all agree that Hebrews belongs in the Bible. But what about those questions? When was it written? Now, this is probably the least problematic of the questions because, well, we don't know most of the dates of origin of biblical books with pinpoint accuracy. Based on several clues within the book of Hebrews, we can be pretty sure that it was written in what we could call the second generation of Christianity. It does not appear to be written by or to those who had been eyewitnesses, right? It wasn't written by those who had first person experience with Jesus, but more likely written among those in the following wave, that second generation, that following wave of the growing church. Well, nevertheless, it is still likely dated very early in the experience of the church. So a pretty good guess would be around the year 80 AD. To whom was it written? A lot of our New Testament books answer that question so clearly that we just go ahead and name the books after their first audience, right? So like Romans was written to the Romans, Galatians written to the churches in the region of Galatia, Corinthians written to the Christians in Corinth. Well, this book carries the title Hebrews, but it's not likely written to those living in Israel, not even limited to Jews, although likely written to those with Jewish backgrounds. So, if we date the book around the year 80 and follow some clues in the book itself, we could have a pretty good guess that it was written to Christians, well, probably in Rome, who were predominantly converts from Judaism. Now, in the early church, the distinction wasn't really clear. Christianity was often viewed as a sect of Judaism in those early years. So furthermore, due to the style and content, we can assume that Hebrews was written to educated people, perhaps even to students. We wouldn't be far off if we thought of it as a kind of early textbook to something like a seminary. All right, why was it written? Again, a number of the other New Testament books include clear evidence that they were originally written to address certain problems or concerns. Hebrews is more of a general Christian theological text. Now, it's clearly meant to encourage and instruct. Perhaps it was written to those wavering in faith, but more likely just written to move people forward in faith and understanding. That sound good? Would you like to move forward in faith and understanding? All right, final question. Who wrote it? To many, that is the million-dollar question. Who wrote it? Now, many have traditionally attributed the book of Hebrews to Paul, although few scholars would agree with that. You know, apparently, attributing the book to the Apostle Paul was, well, sort of a political final straw that broke the camel's back, that got Hebrews into the canon. We can just see it from the contents of our New Testaments. There was a bias toward including books penned by the apostles or those who were eyewitnesses, firsthand accounts of Jesus. So apparently somebody said, well, you know, Paul could have written Hebrews. And it seems that the possibility of Pauline authorship was enough to get the consensus of church leaders like on board during the time of Athanasius, 360, and officially included in the canon by the Council of Carthage in AD 397, 3 centuries after it was penned. Now, we could take a lot of time talking about why Hebrews was not likely penned by Paul. There are volumes written on the subject. Suffice it to say that it doesn't really match Paul's style. As to who did pen Hebrews, well, there are a number of educated guesses that I find interesting. Here are a few of the top guesses, all people who show up elsewhere in the New Testament. Barnabas. Well, this is probably the most popular guess. Barnabas was a companion in ministry with Paul, hence the alignment with these kind of Pauline themes and theologies. And the book of Hebrews is explicitly intended to encourage. It says so. And Barnabas was known as son of encouragement. So, could be Barnabas. Apollos. While not counted among the apostles, Apollos was a contemporary of Paul, an early church planter and preacher and theologian. Could have been Apollos. Luke. Now, I'll admit, this is not a chart-topping guest. Luke. But some have made the case that that Luke wrote Hebrews, right? In addition to the Gospel of Luke and the book of Acts. And I just thought that was interesting since we're in a Luke series. It would be an interesting trilogy from Luke, right? A narrative of Jesus, the Gospel of Luke, a history of the founding of the church, the book of Acts, and a theology textbook. Could have been Luke. Priscilla, along with Aquila. They were partners in ministry. Priscilla, this is probably my favorite guess, although I have no real certainty on the topic for sure. Priscilla, my favorite because it would propose that this New Testament book was written, or at least predominantly co-written, by a woman. If it was penned by Priscilla, well, that would explain why there's no author attached to Hebrews, since, well, it turns out female authorship would have been a liability. Yeah, regardless of who penned Hebrews, these educated guesses informed by the text reveal something worth considering. Hebrews was penned by someone who was highly educated, knowing both Greek culture and Jewish theology. Someone highly educated, well-versed in Greek culture and Jewish theology. All of those guesses would fit the bill there. Greek culture and Jewish theology. Well, while living under Roman rule in the Roman Empire, the culture was predominantly Greek. They spoke Greek. They thought Greek. We ought to get that, right? Most of us are Americans. Our government is American. Our military is American. But our culture is predominantly Western European, specifically British. We do, after all, speak English. Well, that Greek culture prized art and order. Philosophically, those in that Greek culture knew that there was something better. Whether Stoics, thinking they could achieve something better through behavior, or aesthetics, thinking they could achieve something better through beauty, or intellectuals, thinking they could achieve something better through the mind. Greek culture generally believed that the here and now was a poor copy or shadow of a better reality. There was something superior. And we're going to see this reflected in the book of Hebrews. Something superior. Within that broad Greco-Roman culture in the Roman Empire lived a minority, just a few people in the grand scheme of things, the Jews. And their theological outlook was, well, it was different. It was rooted in the idea of covenant, a covenant between God and his chosen people, a covenant broken by sin. Broken by sin from the beginning and repeatedly. A covenant that could be, well, at least temporarily repaired under certain circumstances. A covenant that included the promise of rescue through the Messiah, the Christ. We'll see this too in Hebrews. Hence the title for the series, Christ Superior. Christ is the focus of the book. Hebrews answers the question, who is Jesus? Not through a narrative like Luke and the other Gospels, but more theologically, who is Jesus? Christ. Christ superior. Throughout the book, we'll see Jesus set in the highest place, superior to everything else. And that's how I've set up the series, by the way. Next week, it'll be superior to angels, and then down the road, it'll be superior to salvation, and there'll be others like superior rest and superior sacrifice. Christ superior. Christ superior. Well, before we leave the notion that Hebrews was written both from and to these Greek and Jewish perspectives, I think it's worth noting that our culture is neither. Right? Neither Greek nor Jew. We have this same message, this gospel, this faith, which we are mandated to share, but our culture is neither Greek nor Jew. And I think in a lot of ways, very different from both. Our culture is predominantly comprised of postmodern secularists, especially in our region here in Greater Seattle. As a culture, we generally think that, well, this is all there is. Secularists were generally faithless. If there is spirituality, it's often sort of amorphous and impersonal, not a covenant with a personal God. So if things are going to get better, well, then it's up to us. our trust is in ourselves, our technology, our wealth, and such. Now, that doesn't necessarily render Hebrews irrelevant to our culture, but just as the writer of Hebrews connected the gospel to those two worlds, that Greek world and that Jewish world, we are charged to make the connections, demonstrating and communicating the gospel in and to our culture. Now, there is a thread through Hebrews that I believe does resonate with our culture. And it's along the lines of this: authentic experience. Authentic experience. Our postmodern secular culture places a very high value on authentic experience. Much of what drives our culture, especially among the young, is a search for authenticity. And our culture prizes experience. Again, especially among the young. I mean, doesn't that seem true? When I was young, it seemed like we wanted stuff. The young today, well, seem to want time. They want relationship. They want authenticity. I've landed on a sort of key verse in Hebrews, and I think it aligns with the desire for authentic experience. It's in chapter 10. It says, "Since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened up for us through the curtain that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God." This is the invitation of the book of Hebrews. Let us draw near to God. Let's draw near to God. This authentic experience can be compelling today. Of course, it's likely compelling to us here today just by being here, online or in person or however we're here. Just by being here, we have taken a step drawing near to God. It compels us. But more than that, I think this compels those around us in our networks, in our culture. When we genuinely draw near to God, we are changed, authentically changed. At least we should be. And that change opens the door for others to join us as they seek authentic experience. So, with all that as background, important background that sets the stage for what lies ahead in our series, right? And important background in our own individual study and devotion, let's begin to walk through Hebrews. Our text begins, "In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways." The text begins with a reminder that God has not been silent, that throughout time, he has spoken through his people. Many voices, many circumstances, many times, and many vehicles. He spoke in triumph and failure. He spoke in confidence and anguish, proclamation and tears, words and actions. He provided direction, correction, comfort, rebuke, and help. And while seemingly sporadic, there was a continuity. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. Not merely through his Son, as he did through the prophets, but by his Son. Jesus was not merely the messenger, he is the message. He was not merely words about God or even words from God. Jesus is the Word of God. It says these days, these last days, the days 2 millennia ago that persist today. These days are last days in that the Christ is revealed. He whom God promised through the prophets is known in these last days. He is the Messiah. He is the Christ. He is Jesus. While we do not know how long these last days will continue to persist, we know who finishes these days. His identity is plainly revealed. Jesus is the victor and finisher. He has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom also he made the universe. I mean, these are profound theological statements that further expand our understanding of Jesus. He is the heir, the inheritor of all things, which points to an end, right? And the Son is also the beginning, the means of all creation, eternal and present before the beginning, one with the Father and the Spirit. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. Not only the beginning and the end, but everything in between as well, sustaining all things. Jesus is the foundation for all that is and continues to be now, sustaining all things. Jesus, the radiance of God's glory. What a powerful statement. The radiance of God's glory. The radiance of God's glory was not in crushing power, nor in splendid wealth, or even stunning beauty. The radiance of God's glory was in humility, service, sacrifice, and love. I don't know what image might come to mind when faced with a phrase like the radiance of God's glory. Perhaps it is golden and filled with brilliant light. Maybe it looks like something like what nature has at its very best, with, I don't know, snow-capped mountains or sunlight bouncing off the surf. And I suppose our imaginations are unlimited when imagining the radiance of God's glory. And all of that might be aspects of it, but we do not need to imagine. Jesus is the radiance of God's glory. Jesus demonstrated the radiance of God's glory, not in power, but humility and obedience and even suffering. Humanity, through the most sinister, humiliating, debased plan we had, we threw it at Jesus with the cross, and Jesus transformed it into the radiance of God's glory. The prophets spoke on behalf of God and about God, painting a mere picture of God. Jesus is the exact representation of his being. Not just a dimension or aspect of God, not merely a word for a moment in time, but his very being, exactly his being. We know all of God when we know all of Jesus. This came up quite simply in a conversation with a friend this week. He was sort of confessing his sins informally in the course of a casual conversation. In this case, he was reflecting on how he found himself being a bit selfish, wrapped up in a, well, kind of a self-pity party. And God, through both circumstances and a sense of God's own personal urging, well, snapped him out of it. My pal said something along the lines of, you know, God said to me, "Hey, idiot, get over yourself." Well, then he got a little bashful. He said, "I don't know if God really talks to anyone like that." And I responded by saying, you know, the best way to know God's character and God's ways and attitudes and such is to know Jesus. Knowing Jesus and how he dealt with selfishness, especially from those who ought to know better. I asked if he thought Jesus might speak to him like that. And we agreed that, well, he probably would. So there you go. When we know Jesus, we know God. The exact representation of his being. After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. You know, this conclusion to our short passage for today points to the work Jesus accomplished and the work Jesus continues. The profound work that Jesus accomplished was purification for sins. This is the radiance of God's glory in action, not demanding payment for sins, but providing payment for sins, not merely specifying the way, but being the way. He is the way for all of us and the way for each of us. Friends, our sins are forgiven when we believe. There's forgiveness of sins when we trust in Jesus. And the profound work he continues is at the right hand of the majesty in heaven, alive and active. Jesus reigns even now. Jesus is there, not as prosecutor or even judge, but as advocate. The radiance of God's glory, having paid the price, providing for the purification for sins, well, he stands eternally to advocate and intercede on our behalf. This is Jesus. This is Christ. Christ superior, the glory of God. Christ superior, the victor and finisher of all things. Christ superior, the creator. Christ superior, the sustainer. Christ superior, the redeemer. Christ superior, the mediator. So let's draw near to God. It's a lot to take in, but lean in. Draw near to God. We could be overwhelmed, I mean, just with these first three verses of Hebrews, but stick with us. Let's see what God will do in us and through us. Let's draw near to God. Let's draw near with heart and head and hand. Let's know the love of God as he has revealed it in Jesus and continues to reveal it. Let's dig deep and understand, committing our intellect to God's glorious work in us and through us. And let's apply what we know and are knowing and continue to learn to our work, demonstrating the love of God and the transforming power of Jesus, well, through our actions in all of it. Drawing near to God, let's be trailblazing leaders, showing others that they too can have an authentic experience knowing God eternally by knowing Jesus. Well, let's take a moment now and let's pray together towards that end. Would you pray with me? Our Father, thank you that we know you. We know you now and forever through the exact representation of your being, Jesus. Give us gifts. Give us gifts of faith to believe. Give us gifts of faith to see and experience all that you have for us by knowing Jesus. We believe today. Jesus, I believe. Jesus, we believe. Give us gifts of confidence and courage to draw near to you. Give us gifts of opportunity to demonstrate all that you are doing in us. We thank you again. We thank you again through and for your Son. And we pray again in that glorious name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, friends, thanks again for being with us. Stay connected. Would love your feedback. Touch base with us. Let us know if we can be serving you in any way. Be intentional. Talk to somebody. Say hi. And stay tuned. We continue to gather on Tuesday mornings for prayer, and we'll be at this online for, well, we're at it. This is our new way. If you can be with us in the auditorium, great. But if this is your home, we're glad to have you here as well. Well, let me bless you before you go. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, both now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. Grace be with you all, friends. Have a great week. God bless you.